Have you ever thought about what really happens when the government makes something cheaper with a subsidy? You'd think the answer is simple, right? We just pay less. But it's actually a fascinating economic puzzle, and the answer has a surprising twist that might just change how you look at a simple discount.
So, here's the big question we're tackling. A government subsidy lowers the price of a product. Because it's cheaper, we buy more of it. That makes sense. But what happens to our total spending? You know, the price we pay multiplied by the amount we buy. Does that number actually go up, or does it go down? Just take a second. What's your gut reaction?
You'd think, right? The price tag is lower, so our total spending must go down. But hold on, we're also buying more of this stuff. So those two forces, a lower price and a higher quantity, are basically in a tug of war. The economic reality is it's way more complicated than it looks on the surface.
All right, to crack this puzzle open, we've got to go back to basics. We need to see how a market works before the government steps in and shakes things up. Let's build a quick picture.
It all starts with us, the buyers, and our behavior is pretty predictable. When the price of something is crazy high, we buy less of it. When that price drops, we want more. That simple relationship between price and how much we want to buy creates what economists call the demand curve, and it always slopes downward.
Then you've got the sellers, the producers. For them, the logic is the total opposite. The higher the price they can get for their product, the more they want to make and sell. It's just good business. This creates the supply curve, which, you guessed it, slopes upward.
So you've got buyers wanting low prices and sellers wanting high prices. Where does the market settle? Right where those two curves cross. That intersection is called market equilibrium. It's the sweet spot where the amount being sold is exactly the amount people want to buy. This gives us our starting point, an initial price, we'll call it P0, and an initial quantity, Q0.
Okay, so we have our happy, balanced market. Everybody knows the price. Now, let's introduce our game changer, the government subsidy.
So how does this work? It's pretty simple, really. The government goes to producers and says, hey, for every single item you sell, we're going to give you some cash. Now, if you're a producer, this is amazing news. It feels like your cost of making each item just dropped, which means you're super motivated to produce and sell more.
And this has a very real, very direct effect on our model. For the producers, it's like their supply curve just got bigger, expanding outward by the exact cash amount of that subsidy. They are now willing to supply more units at any given price.
So what does this do to our graph? Boom. The entire supply curve just slides over to the right. This shift represents the new reality in the market. Thanks to the subsidy, there's more of the product available at every single price point.
With the supply curve now in a new spot, that old balance is history. The market has to find a new sweet spot, a new equilibrium. So what on earth does this mean for us, the people actually buying this stuff?
The market, as it always does, is going to find its new point of balance. And that happens right at the new intersection, where our original demand curve crosses that new subsidy-shifted supply curve.
And if we look at this new balance point, what do we see? Well, compared to where we started, two things have clearly changed. The new price for us, P1, is lower than the old price. And the new quantity sold, Q1, is higher than before. So for the consumer, it looks like a win-win. Cheaper prices and more stuff.
Okay, let's just quickly recap who gets what in this new deal. We, the consumers, get a lower price and we buy more. The producers, they actually get a higher price than what we pay because they get our money plus the government subsidy. And who foots the bill for that subsidy on every unit sold? Well, that's the government, which, of course, is funded by taxpayers.
All right, all the pieces are on the board. We've set the scene, we see the prices down, we see the quantities up. Now we can finally go back to that original question and solve this spending puzzle once and for all.
So here we are again, at the heart of the puzzle. We have a lower price that's trying to pull our total spending down, but a higher quantity that's trying to pull it right back up. It's a tug of war. Which side is stronger? Does our total spending go up, down, or maybe it doesn't even change?
And here's the cool part. The key to unlocking this whole thing isn't really about the subsidy itself. It's about us. It's about our behavior as consumers. The entire answer is hidden in the specific shape of the demand curve for whatever product we're talking about.
And this brings us to a really important idea in economics, elasticity of demand. Now, don't let the fancy term scare you. It's super simple. All it measures is how sensitive we are to a price change. Basically, when a price drops, do we go out and buy a ton more, or do we just buy a little bit more?
Think of it like this. If demand is elastic, it's like a stretchy rubber band.
A small drop in price causes us to stretch our wallets and buy a whole lot more. Think about things you don't strictly need, like movie tickets. But if demand is inelastic, it's more like a rock. It's rigid. A price drop doesn't really change our habits much. We only buy a little more. Think of essentials, like gasoline.
And this chart says it all. For those stretchy products with elastic demand, our total spending actually goes up. The increase in how much we buy is just massive. But for those rigid, inelastic goods, look at that. Our total spending actually decreases.
So here it is, the final answer to our puzzle. If the demand for a product is elastic, then yes, our total spending increases. The huge jump in the amount we buy completely overpowers the effect of the lower price. But if demand is inelastic, then no, our spending goes down. The price drop is the bigger factor, and the small increase in quantity just isn't enough to make up for it. And that's it. Puzzle solved.
Okay, so this is some cool economic theory, but why does any of it actually matter? Well, it turns out this concept has huge real-world implications that affect everything from government policy to what's in your wallet. Imagine you're a government, thinking about subsidizing an everyday essential, like milk or bread. You absolutely have to ask yourself, is the demand for this stuff elastic or inelastic? Because the answer tells you what's going to happen. Will your subsidy just result in people spending less money, or will it actually encourage them to buy and consume significantly more? It's a critical question for making good policy.
So I'll leave you with this to think about. If the price of gasoline suddenly dropped by, say, 20%, how much more would you honestly drive? Now, what if movie tickets dropped by 20%? Your answer to that question tells you everything you need to know about your own demand, and it shows you how this powerful economic idea is at play all around us, every single day.